So let's look at some regular solvers. I'm just going to go to the side view here. I'm going to go ahead and create a regular solver. Look at your attributes and you'll see that it's currently set as an RP solver. You have the automatic set for it to go ahead and snap back to itself. So if it goes beyond the boundaries, it also means that when we rotate this around, it follows along with it. So it picks that up. The only reason why that wouldn't happen is if you've gone ahead and added constraints to this. We also have the solver type is listed here, so you can go ahead and change to a different type if you wanted to alter the type now that we've got those other ones created. And it says IKFK control right here, but it automatically has an IKFK control on it. That's something separate. We'll discuss it at another point in time. So what else can we do with this? Well, let's go ahead and create what would be referred to as a two-bone solver. Now remember, again, these are joints, not bones, but you often hear terminology basically saying a two-bone solver, which is three joints. And instead of that, I want to go ahead and add some kind of twist thing in here or something like that. And if I were to go into my skeleton, insert joint tool, and I have to make sure that I'm in an orthographic view and not a perspective view for this. Can go ahead and just drag out a few. There we go. I'll add again a regular RP solver. And when I pull this up, you notice that I get some bending and bowing in there, which maybe I don't want. So if I go to these bones here, you'll notice that there is a degrees of freedom and a stiffness value. The stiffness value is basically put in there to allow you to give sort of a preference how much these individual joints will resist bending. So you can add a resistance there. Now what I've noticed is that it is a little bit finicky when you use resistance. Resistance will allow you to say, okay, I want this one to bend a lot less than this one, which will give more of the bending in that region. But sometimes you can have some jumping or popping that will happen in there, so I don't really use those. But you can use this guy, which is the degrees of freedom, which is the same kind of thing. It's just not a various degree. It's just on or off. So we just go ahead and turn those guys off. What happens is the rotation in Z, which as you can see is this rotation. We've removed that. And now you see that they're perfectly straight. So when it does the solve, you can still do twist on these guys. Sort of a distributed twist if you wanted. But it doesn't bend in that other direction. So that's kind of cool. Let's add a pull vector to this, which is a chain up vector. Just go ahead and create a locator or any kind of object that you want. Use a curve if you wanted. Just put it out in the front of it. And this is, again, where Maya will be a little bit different from the default of Softimage. Typically, it's in front, where I believe the default in Softimage is usually behind. It's a master. This is a slave object. Constrain, and we go to pull vector. And of course, as you would have expected, we get this basic kind of movement here. So let's just quickly blow that away. I'll show you behavior of an SC control. So I'm going to go ahead and create some bones there. Go to my tool. I'm just going to open up the tool options here. And instead of that one, I'll just change to a single chain solver. And single chain is usually utilized for something that is not multi-chain, but you can use it multi-chain. So you could go from here to here instead of here to here, but I can use it here like that. And instead of putting a chain up vector on it, you can get the twist off the handle directly. So this is usually used in things like the reverse foot setups and some other situations. Go back into here. Multiple bones, skeleton, and I'll use the IK spline handle tool, which has multiple settings. We've got for it to root itself on the curve, to auto parent the curve or not to the setup, to automatically create the curve, or you can turn that off and pick your own curve. And then we have this auto simplify curve option here, which allows us to pick the number of vertices that will go on here. Now, the number of spans, it says 1. This is basically a statement that will have 4 points. So it's always this number plus 3. So 1 plus 3, so that's 4, 5, 6, and 7. That's how many points will appear on this. If you want more, then of course you have to go ahead and tell it not to auto create the curve, and then you'll have that. I'll just ask you to snap it. So I'm just going to allow it to auto create. And I'm just going to click. And when you're doing IK, it really doesn't matter if you click on the top or the bottom of the node first. It uses the hierarchy to calculate. And I'm just going to throw the handle itself, which has a bunch of options we'll take a look at in a moment. But I'm just going to throw the handle itself in here. And I'll actually throw the joints in there as well. And what you'll see is it's created a curve, which has control vertices on it. And so if I were to grab those control vertices and just turn this on, you see it has control like that. And these guys can be given things like clusters. So if I want to create deformers, clusters, which is basically just a handle. It's basically a node, a DAG node that has this pivot information so that we can animate it directly. And then you do that the same thing to the other ones as well. And then you can hand animate these guys. So those are the main IK handles that you would be using in here. Let's create one more actually before we stop. So if I were to go ahead and create just like a regular rotation plane solver and do this, you see how most of the bending has happened on the first and last joint. There is a little bit of bending in between, but not really enough. Well, if I go to my spring solver instead, everything is distributed evenly. So we'll add some more depth to the next video, but that's it for this one.